You might think, if you didn't know any better, that all orchestral musicians are more or less alike. That's because you've never played the oboe. If you have, then you know that oboe players are not like the rest of us. For one thing, they make their living by blowing through a piece of grass. Not just any piece, but one painstakingly whittled over the course of hours. In fact, they do the whittling themselves in a lifelong quest for the perfect reed. And of course, they do this for a reason. After all, the oboe has some of the great themes in the symphonic literature. But you simply have to ask yourself, why would anybody want to play the oboe?
Playing the oboe is a very dangerous thing. The reed is really literally different every time you play it.
You might look at oboe playing as a kind of musical bungee jumping.
Well, I don't think it's peculiar. I've done it all my life.
It might actually be somebody who likes to be a bit different, who likes to be a bit eccentric.
The way it usually works is that somebody comes along and says, who wants to be in the band? And there's a clarinet, there's a trumpet, there's fiddles, but there's certainly not an oboe.
My music director gave me this instrument that hardly had any keys and was hoping to discourage me. But after 6 months, I knew this was the instrument.
I think that probably no child is ever born saying that he wants to play the oboe or she wants to play the oboe. But a lot of kids are born saying, I want to do what my father does or my older brother or sister does or my grandfather.
Well, my dad was an oboe player, and his dad was an oboe player. My dad started the business in 1931.
When you go into Paul Laubin's shop, don't expect high tech. He's one of the great old craftsmen. He loves to feel the wood, and it's essential for him.
Well, we make a total of 40, 43 instruments a year. I can look at a piece of wood, and I can have a pretty good idea of what that oboe is going to be like when it's finished. And that's just from experience.
I spend about 20 hours a week in rehearsals and concerts with the New York Philharmonic. And I spend about 10 hours a week devoted to reed making. The reed comes from one piece of cane folded over and cut. And the tone, quality, and intonation, responsiveness, the things that are important when I play, derive from the reed itself. And the inside of the reed is just as important as the outside. So I'm basically scooping out the inside of the reed. It's a little bit like the inside of a violin. I have to have the cane thin enough, ultimately, to be able to vibrate.
It's just a wonderful thing to know that your oboe reed is part of that instrument, and it's a new part of the instrument every day you play.
I have to put this cane on the tube, which I said is an extension of the bore of the instrument. So the end of the oboe is not any bigger than that at the top. And when this goes in, then the conical bore of the oboe is extended to this point.
The most important thing is that the bore is straight. The bore is too big, it won't respond properly. If it's too small, it won't respond properly.
If the reed is structurally weak or deformed, then I will have to compensate for that with my embouchure, with my mouth. Now what I have to do is scrape from the outside, and then I'll have the two pieces of cane that actually vibrate to make the tone. Let me scrape a little bit out of the back just to give some depth. I'm interested in how much of my potential is spent just getting started. And so if I go from nowhere, from zero, that's pretty up near the limit. So that's why this reed really flunks the response test, because it should begin to make a noise much closer to zero than that.
Creating the sound, that is the way you create the sound, by the quality of the reed, and that involves this kind of handicrafts, if you will. I don't know if they would like that term.
I can make a reed in about 2 minutes, and I might spend 2 days trying to refine it and then tear it up. I mean, I'd say typically at the New York Philharmonic, I really these days make a reed almost for every piece.
This key here is made out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different pieces.
Different brands of oboes have different number of keys. If you look at all the individual parts, there's close to 500.
Now see, that just attacks me to the limit to get something that Mr. Mazur would never accept as good enough, you see. So of course I would have to spend another few hours in here to give me a better result than that.
Oboe players get the plaintive, sort of soulful melodies.
It's a very high-pressure instrument. There's a tension in the line that you can't get from any other instrument.
Playing the oboe is risky. You can't pick it up like a flute and just blow and something's going to come out. You don't know.
I have to hold the reed together to keep it in tune. I have to squeeze the daylights out of it with my lips to keep the tone from spreading. You know, I have to play at the very tip to keep it from being too bright. And then I hope that I can play louder and softer and higher and lower and stay in tune.
The instrument is so risky and so demanding, and the stakes are so high. One might be surprised that someone might choose to play an instrument as difficult and unforgiving as an oboe.
I'm addicted to the sound. I'm addicted to the feeling that you have when you're playing the instrument.
There's a temptation to seek continually to find that perfect voice. And maybe I really should be practicing more.
Evolution thrives on diversity. We would long since have died out as a species if we weren't different from one another. Same thing with music. How boring music would be if there was only one piece or for one instrument. We can fortunately never program what's going to fascinate somebody.
You get that little buzz in your mouth, and you hear that sweet, piercing sound, and you decide nothing else will ever be good enough for you. It's a strange thing, the oboe. We don't know where oboists come from, but thank God they're here.